So, well, I mean, it's hello, everyone. It's great to see you all again. What I ended up doing, I really kind of structured this more as a science discussion, as a formal colloquium. So I have something like 40 slides for, 50 plus 10, which is comfortable. So don't hesitate to interrupt me, for questions or discussions or anything like that as we go. So as some of you are aware, about five years ago, a research project that actually started when I was still here in my last years at HAO in collaboration with Piotr Smolarkiewicz, who back then was at MCube, back when we were at FLABS in the same, on the same site, finally came to doing something interesting. And that something interesting was that we got these MHD simulations of the solar convection zone building up large-scale magnetic field that would undergo polarity reversals that in many ways look like what the sun was doing. So this was a rather exciting situation, and we've been basically riding on that. That's one of the main research projects still ongoing in my group in Montreal. So this there's six bullets there, but there's actually really three things I want to do now. The first part of it, I'll give you a bit of an overview of where we are with these simulations. Not so much the technical numerics, but what we're doing with them and what these things look like. And then I've picked two interesting sub-projects, if you wish, that we've been doing with these models. One is we've been analyzing in the simulation things that look like double dynamo behavior, and that is interesting because, as I will show you, there's a lot of solar activity indicators that seem to show short variability timescale. Short, I mean, anywhere between 6 months and 2 years, and we seem to see that in the simulation, and we think we understood where it comes from, at least in the simulation. Doesn't mean the sun does the same thing, but this is kind of interesting. And the other thing that I thought would be really interesting for people, especially here, is we think that we're finding evidence for large-scale MHD instabilities taking place in the stable layers of our simulation, and that is a local specialty at HAO. It's been for quite a while, so I threw in some stuff about that. Another extremely exciting.
Just quick question: what is double dynamo? What is a double dynamo?
It's like two dynamos that run side by side. Yeah. So and we think that's what's happening in there. One very interesting thing that we pulled out of these simulations that I decided not to talk about, even though in some sense it's perhaps the most interesting thing that perhaps has come out of that, is we are finding that the magnetic cycles we have in there modulate convective energy flux. It basically modulates how much convective luminosity is going through the simulation. In a way that looks a lot like what the sun is doing, the simulation is a little bit brighter at the maximum of the activity cycle than at the minimum. And we're currently, working a lot to try and figure out how this is actually taking place inside the simulation. The reason I decided not to talk about that is that the graduate student who is really spearheading that project is turning in his thesis next month and will be coming to CU Boulder as the first Hale postdoctoral fellow to work with the group there. So I didn't want to steal his punchlines. So presumably once he's here, give him a few weeks to settle in, and then he can maybe come and give a science discussion about this stuff, because it's quite exciting as well. And I actually probably will not have much in here of conclusions, because this is all very much ongoing stuff, and it's, I'm very much interested in getting your feedback on this as well. You all have probably seen things like that. This is a synoptic magnetogram of the sun. So you take a magnetogram of the sun, you average things in longitudes, so you get the mean magnetic field as a function of latitude, you stack that day after day after day, and you get a picture of what the solar surface is doing over very long time scales. So there's a lot of stuff in there. This is what's left of the sunspot magnetic fields when you zonally average them in longitudes. They tend to appear in pairs of opposite polarity, so they almost average out to zero when you average in longitude, and you see the dipole moment of the sun as well that reverses polarity at about the time of solar maximum. You see evidence for transport of magnetic field decay products of sunspots being carried by the surface flows and diffusion to high latitudes and contributing or even possibly even driving the dipole reversal. When you look at a thing like that, you're looking at a combination of processes. You're looking at this really reflects generation of magnetic flux ropes that takes place deep inside the sun. This transport and accumulation of fields, you know, is really a surface process. So there's a lot of things going on a wide range of timescales. So the challenge is to try to simulate all that. Now, from the point of view of dynamo theory, I mean, I still think that we don't understand how the solar cycle works. People have been at this problem for quite a long time. There's different types of approaches you can take. And well, this is kind of an oversimplification, but there's something that people sometimes call the kinematic dynamo problem. And this is, in some sense, at first glance, a simple problem. You take the MHD fluid equation, so that's basically massaging Maxwell's equation into a form that's applicable to a, you know, a conducting fluid, an electrically conducting fluid that is globally neutral. And this is pretty much everybody agrees that for physical conditions inside the sun, this is really the equations that you're supposed to work with. So there's no controversy at that level. So if you take that equation, the idea is the kinematic problem is to say, okay, what flow field should I put into this equation? And only that equation, without doing any dynamics, what kind of flow field should I put in there, you know, to get something that comes out, a magnetic field that comes out that looks like, you know, that's being amplified? And that is actually much harder than you might think. Now, if you want to make it even harder, you say, okay, I'm not going to come up with a flow. I will basically set up conditions, convection, for example, where I get a flow that is dynamically consistent that can also act to amplify the magnetic field. And that's quite harder. And if you want to make it even harder, you say, well, I want to do all of that, and what comes out should look like the magnetic field of the sun and stars. So this is getting pretty hard. And there's no consensus, especially at that level, on how all of this takes place. But one thing that pretty much is pretty much clear is that turbulence, or, you know, convective turbulence, or any sort of flow with chaotic trajectories, in some sense, will do very well at this, and certainly contributes to what happens there, although the door is open for many other processes taking place to contribute to giving us a magnetic field that looks like what the sun is doing. So that's this famous equation I was thinking about. And in some sense, the big question is that, so this is the flow, the total flow, that's the magnetic field, that's just magnetic diffusivity inversely proportional to conductivity, and this is what drives the evolution of the magnetic field. That thing, so if you think of the large scale magnetic field, this thing is structured on the scales, on the scale of the sun, and varies in time over a time scale of decades. This guy is dominated by convection. Convection has time scales that go from deep down in the convection zone, maybe a month, down to like hours near the surface. And it has scales, you know, that are much smaller than the size of the system. So this magnetic self-organization problem or conundrum, as it's being called these days, basically is saying, how can you take a flow that has a coherence time, you know, that is quite short, months, hours, days, well, more like days to weeks, and, you know, a length scale that is really, really tiny, and how can you have a flow like that build up a magnetic field that evolves, that is structured on much larger time scale and evolves on much longer temporal scales? So you need something to achieve large-scale organization. And, you know, we're not alone in this. We do have physical effects that actually help. Rotation is one. Differential rotation is another one. And in the context of turbulence, under certain circumstances, the convective turbulence that you get inside the sun and stars can lead to inverse cascade type effects, where you pump energy from small scales to large scales. So somehow these processes, most likely acting in conjunction, is actually what is taking a small scale, short coherence time turbulence flow and building a large scale, long coherence time magnetic field. This is an example of what rotation can do. These are Mol-Vibey projections. This is really the surface of a simulation, a purely hydrodynamical simulation, this one, no magnetic fields. And this is basically the same type of simulations that I'll be showing you later. So it's a solar-like sphere of electrically conducting fluid. We're looking at the surface. The color scale is the radial flow speed. So yellow stuff is upflow. These dark, narrow things are downflows. So if you just set up convection, this thing is being terminally forced and it convects. you get this assemblage of like cells with broad upflows surrounded by a network of narrow downflows that is completely typical of thermal convection. Now, if you take that, and you know, other simulation models give the same thing. If you take that and you spin this thing at the solar rate, this is what, and keep everything else the same, this is what you get. So you dramatically change the structure of convection. And in particular, you tend to create in the equator these elongated cells that are parallel to the rotation axis. And this is basically a consequence of the Coriolis force constraining the fluid motions. So if you're rotating, if your rotation period is comparable or even smaller than the typical convective turnover time, then at that point, the convective cells are influenced by rotation. If the convection is so vigorous that the cells, you know, overturn and disappear on the time scales much, much shorter than the rotation period, they don't know rotation is there. There's this thing called the Rossby number that quantifies this. But the point being that for the sun, we think we are supposed to be in this regime where rotation does affect what convection is doing. Another consequence of rotation is that on small scales, the Coriolis force is introducing correlations between turbulent velocity components. And this leads to something that we call in hydro Reynolds stresses. It's a force. It looks like a body force from the point of view of the large-scale flow. And that body force can drive large-scale flows. And one large-scale flow that it drives is called differential rotation. We know since Galileo and company that the sun rotates from tracking sunspots. But since the 19th century, with sunspots measurement and Doppler measurement, we know that actually the rotation is not constant at the surface. The equator is rotating quickly, and you know it's decreasing as you move to the pole. And since the late 1980s, with Hale and seismology, we know that this angular gradient is sustained across the convection zone, all the way down to the interface with the radiative core, which is about at 0.7 here. The outer 30% of the sun are convecting, and the inner part is stably stratifying. And simulations run in this parameter regime where rotation does affect convection actually do this. This is a hydro simulation that we've carried out, and you know, the color scale is the same, but the range is unmarked, which is unfortunate. You know, I should fix this to make it look more impressive, at least with this one. And generally, these simulations do typically lead to equators rotating faster than poles. For reasons having to do with the way we do this, we're capable of producing a sensible tachocline, in the sense that we have this tiny shear layer that builds up where we see one here. At the equator, things are not so good. Our shear is really concentrated within the convection zone, whereas here it's really, again, spread in this layer. But it's actually, to a first approximation, it's not so bad. If I keep everything the same and I put magnetic fields in there, then the field opposes the angular velocity gradient, so I reduce that shear a lot, I kill off a lot of that tachocline, but I still maintain this pole to equator temperature difference, and not temperature difference, but angular velocity difference. So differential rotation is an important organizing agent because it is structured on the scale of the system. So a piece of magnetic field that's here is being sheared in a way that is not like random just due to convective turbulence. There's a definite systematic shearing direction that is associated with this large-scale flow. So now what we want to do is make simulations that somehow capture all that. It's not just a matter of capturing the evolution of the field, but because the evolution of that field is driven by these flows, you need to be able to have a simulation of convection that is run in a way such that it drives large-scale flows and amplifies the magnetic field. So the simulations we've been running with this code, I'll explain a bit about it, called ULAG-MHD. This is really work that I started, as I said, you know, like 15 years ago now with Piotr Smolarkiewicz, who was in MCube at the time, and Mihai Gizaru, former colleague of mine in Montreal, has contributed a lot to that as well. And so I want to say a few words about that. The way you set these simulations up is, that's kind of conventional. Pretty much everybody who does that does it that way. So you simulate a thick spherical shell, the outer part of the sun, if you want. Like, we go from 0.61 in fractional radius to 0.96 or something like that. We exclude the surface for reasons I'll get to in a second. So in the outer 30% of the sun, you know, we set up a background stratification that is convectively unstable. And in our simulations, we actually keep a stable fluid layer underneath. So we have a stratification that is convectively stable from 0.61 to 0.72 and convectively unstable all the way up to the top of the simulation. Important things in there is that this thing is rotating and it's stratified. We have about 3.5 density scale heights across the domain. And we run that in the inelastic approximation, which is just a way of dealing with a stratified fluing system without having to track sound waves. So I can't do helioseismology with that. Well, actually I could, but not in the usual sense that one would think about. There are no sound waves in this simulation. Now, convective structures are obviously going to be this color scale. These are upflows and downflows. So evidently, if I have a mesh like this, the best I can do is produce structures that will extend across a few cells. So that will impose a limit on the vigor of turbulence, on the size of turbulent structures that I can capture. It will impose a limit on the range, the extent of the inertial range of turbulence that I can model with a thing like that. So even with very high resolution simulations, pretty much the best stuff we can do nowadays, you seldom manage to exceed 10 to the 3 in the magnetic Reynolds numbers and viscous Reynolds number. We run, most of the simulations I'll show you today, run around 100 or even a little bit less. So it's significantly larger than 1, which is good, but we're still a long way from the 10 to the 8 or 10 to the 9 that you would normally calculate for the solar interior. So that's certainly a limitation. We run in a regime where convection is strongly influenced by rotation. And the stratification, one of the effects that it will have, you can actually see the alignment of downflow cells along the rotation axis. Here they tend to be radial, but by the time you get to the equator, they are definitely, you know, lining up with the rotation. And because of stratification, we'll get a lot of downward pumping of the magnetic field. Now, these are general features that are characteristic of all simulations of this type, these general features. These are always dangerous slides to come up with, because you always end up leaving out someone, you know, possibly someone in the room, you know, which is even worse. But I could easily make 4 or 5 slides like this. But the point being that this business has been around for a while, and in fact, it started here with Peter Gilman back in the early 80s, who really produced, and also Gary Glatzmeyer, who was a grad student working here as well in the years following, who produced the first, you know, global large-scale simulation of solar convection. It didn't went on for quite a while, and you know, in between, you know, learning about this and getting bigger and bigger computer, we're now at a stage where some of these simulations are reaching turbulent intensities and resolutions such that we can start to produce. I'm talking global simulations here that do the whole sun, that can produce flux rope-like structures that, you know, you could interpret as stuff that would give rise to sunspots. So there's been a tremendous amount of progress, if you want. Across this. But in terms of things like cycles, large-scale cycles, it really starts, you know, around 2010, which is not, you know, it's just 4 years ago, you know, 4 or 5 years ago that these simulations have started to produce large-scale fields that look like they want reverse polarity. So it took 20 years, but we finally caught up with our geodynamo friends from that point of view. The equations being solved are really the MHD equations. So this is just mass conservation, F equals ma, Newton's law for fluid energy conservation, and this is basically Faraday's law, induction. So the physics is in principle well understood. There's nothing quantized in there. There's no relativity, no strings, no dark matter, no dark energy. It's 19th century stuff. It's actually in principle straightforward, but in practice it gets nasty. So the code that we've been using, and again, I can discuss the technicalities with people interested in, if any, you know, after the talk, but we started off with this thing called ULAG, which was Eulerian Lagrangian, which is really a general flow solver that was designed in M-cube mostly for, you know, mesoscale meteorology application at first, but it proved to be really efficient and has been generalized to all kinds of things. And that was developed by Piotr and a bunch of people at M-cube with a lot of help from the people at the, what are they called these days, the supercomputer guys? SISM, that's what they're called. Okay, well, these guys. So our contribution to this, and this is what I was starting with Piotr when I was still here, was to take this existing code and just put MHD into it, add something to it, add magnetic fields. And this is something we did mostly in Montreal and in close collaboration with Piotr, because he knows this thing inside out. It's his baby. It turned out to be an extremely powerful and efficient piece of machinery that we ended up with. And I really shouldn't take any credit for that, because that thing was really, really well done. And in particular, the parallelization was absolutely outstanding. Our MHD version remains the one piece of code that the Canadian Supercomputing Network keeps using all the time for their, when they test new machines. I mean, it scales up to, you know, scales up almost perfectly. And again, it's mostly because of the work that was done here by Piotr and the guys at CISM. Our only merit in that is not to have screwed things up. That's pretty much the only merit we had in having this thing going, plus putting in the MHD. And at the core of this ULAG machine, and of course at the core of our MHD version, is this advection algorithm. This is the part that does the DDT plus U dot grad, you know, when you write the MHD equation. It uses this thing called MP beta, which is a tensor multiple positive definite advection and transport algorithm. And it's basically one of these non-oscillatory forward in time upwind type schemes. And these have been around for quite, these classes of schemes have been around for quite a while. They are known to be prone to the introduction of a lot of artificial numerical dissipation into the equations that you solve. And the way Piotr and his friends have bypassed this problem is that they've made this iterative upwind scheme that makes an upwind step that's very dissipative, but then uses the truncation error terms to compute a nine-tie diffusive velocity that corrects the correction, the solution back, and then they can do another iteration and so on. And the end result of that is that you can really, while running in this upwind framework, you keep numerical dissipation to a minimum. And it, in the context of the hydro version of this thing, it has been proven rigorously that this is really equivalent to an adaptive subgrid model. This dissipation turns on when shears in the flow, or in our case, in magnetic fields, become too high, and turns off when it's not needed. So this is an interesting property that allows us to get to reach fairly turbulent regimes on relatively small meshes, smaller than you might think. Another unusual thing with respect to what people normally do with thermal convection is that instead of applying a heat flux at the base of our fluid layer or temperature difference through the boundaries, we pump heat in and out of the system by a Newtonian cooling type term that is volumetric. It is distributed across the convecting layer. This is a rather unnatural way to do convection at first glance. It's a trick that these guys were using to do the planetary boundary layer in meteorology. The lower atmosphere in the morning, you know, the atmosphere is heated by the sun, but not directly. The ground is heated, and then the ground heats the atmosphere again. So if you run a model over a day, the first thing that happens in the morning is the sun heats the ground, and then the ground starts to heat the very bottom part of the atmosphere. So if you don't capture that thermal boundary layer really, really well, you're not getting the proper heat flux up into the atmosphere in the first 6 hours of daylight, and then the weather then goes to pots, right? It does whatever it wants. So this volumetric forcing, instead of doing the boundary layer, they distribute the heating over this profile of volumetric forcing, and they calibrated that on direct numerical simulations and observations, and it works quite well. So this is basically what we adopted as a forcing scheme. This is especially important in our case because we have this stably stratified fluid layer at the bottom of our domain. If we really would impose a heat flux across the system, like most people do, we would have this very long thermal relaxation timescale problem to deal with, you know, before our simulation would really reach stationarity, and that can take a long time. And because we force volumetrically rather than through boundaries, we kind of sidestep that problem. Now, we also have a rather strongly stable stratification in that stable fluid layer, which is interesting for reasons that you'll see soon. And this thing, we can run this thing either as a conventional large AV simulation with, you know, explicit viscous or only dissipative terms, or we can run it relying only on this numerical dissipation, which is the mode in which we've been running all the simulations I will show you. So this is a typical example of what these things do, That's we're near the surface. This is temperature perturbation. This is radial flow speed, and this is radial magnetic field on this color scale. And what you see there is that the field that you build up is really on the same scale as that of convection, which is exactly what you would expect, right? That's what I was saying before. The U that you put in your induction equation is a typical length scale. So that's the length scale that you expect to come up in the magnetic field. All the animations I'm going to show today are actually on this website of ours. So if you go there and this becomes a problem, you look in the right-hand side to the button that says English. You click that, and this will turn into what we do, and this will turn into MHD simulations. And from there on, you should be good. And you get to these things, and many other ones. So this does the thing that you would expect, except that this field doesn't look like it has a large-scale component, right? You don't see much of a dipole in there. You don't see anything like that. But still, things are happening. You just don't see them at the surface. These are time series, same simulation. This is covered. These are solar days. That's about a month. So this covers about 12 years, I think, whereas this guy covers almost 200. This panel is just the beginning of that. Log scale here, linear scale on that one. This is kinetic energy. This is magnetic energy. So we start with our sphere of fluid that is non-convecting, so it's an unstable stratification of fluid at rest. We have a random seed magnetic field, and at time zero, we give it a little thump, and this thing starts. The forcing makes this a high Taylor number type situation. So convection kicks in really quick, you know, and whoop, and then eventually stabilizes to some sort of statistically stationary state. The magnetic energy at first, you know, once convection stabilizes, this grows up exponentially, just like the textbook says. You know, it's basically this is a fixed velocity, so you can solve the induction equation as an eigenvalue problem and look for exponentially growing solution. And that's what this thing is doing for quite a while. And then it looks like it settles. And you expect that as well. Once the Lorentz force of the magnetic field becomes strong enough to oppose convection, you know, induction starts to slow down. And the bit of simulation that you've seen before is taken here, around here somewhere. It's that part. But then if you wait long enough, you know, this keeps going up and up and up and up and up, and you think, what's going on? And you start to see a noticeable decrease in kinetic energy. And if you now go on much longer time scale, you see the exponential growth, we're linear here, you know, you start to see this, this cycle-like affair that shows up in the magnetic energy. So to know what is happening, you need to go deep into the solution. That's the same simulation we were looking at before, looking at drawn on the equatorial plane, the rotation axis like that. That's just temperature perturbation again. We're going to go in now. We're going to go in and look at the toroidal magnetic field at the base of the convecting layer. Not at the base of the simulation, but at the base of the convecting layer. So there's lots of...
Previous slide.
Yes?
Where are those densities evaluated?
This is integrated over the whole domain.
So you've got the same amount of energy in the magnetic field as you're in kinetic energy? Or
here it looks like that, but this is because we get lots of accumulation of magnetic field, strong magnetic field in the stable layer. If I were to integrate only over the convecting layers, this one would be about a factor of 10 larger than that one. I'll actually show you
what's still only a factor of 10.
Well, it's actually pretty good.
Yeah,
I think. But anyway, you'll see. I'll actually get to that. Or I'll give you elements of answer to this pretty soon. So we're going to go in, and what you'll see on the sphere, color-coded, is the toroidal zonal magnetic component, the part that we think gives rise to sunspot. We're at the base of the convection zone, so there's still quite a bit of turbulence there, so the field is really choppy. Okay, there's really a lot of structure to it, but you can see already that at fairly high latitudes, there seems to be something systematic going on in terms of bands, structures stretched in longitude. So this is now longitude-latitude. And these are these bands I was telling you about. That's negative, that's positive. So we're going to run that for 200 years.
Paul, could you indicate something like what is the 30 degrees latitude?
30 degrees is about down here.
Approximately
down
here.
So this is peaking at something like 55.
Okay.
There's a projection effect because I really unrolled the sphere. You know?
Yeah.
But if you watch this thing go, we're positive in the north, negative in the south, very turbulent, a lot of things happening. And eventually, this thing looks like it goes away, and it will rebuild with, you know, the opposite polarity. So this is really a polarity reversal that's taking place in those deep layers. It's building up again with the opposite polarity. This sets the base of the convection zone, the interface, you know, between the convecting layers and the stable layers. So there's still a lot of action going on there. Okay, now, if I take a thing like this, this is latitude, longitude, right, and I average it zonally, I can construct a time-latitude diagram of that axisymmetric toroidal component at the base of the convection zone. That's like a butterfly diagram, in some sense, if sunspots come from there. And that's what these things look like. So North Pole, South Pole, equator, running over 180 years in this case. So you can see that my activity belts, call them that, are peaking at way too high latitudes compared to the sun, right? Like 55 degrees or something like that. But I do get fairly regular cycles, anti-symmetric about the equatorial plane, and that part is nice. Not much going on at the equator. I can repeat the same process of averaging zonally, and instead of cutting in latitude time, I can fix the latitude and look at the radius time diagram. That's what this bottom one is. The interface between the convecting and stable layers is this place. So this is all convecting, this is stable, and you can see that there's a big difference in the strength of the field that piles up immediately beneath the base of the convection zone and what runs, you know, within the convection zone. But this axisymmetric component really pervades the whole convection zone, and it turns out that downward pumping leads to accumulation in the outer reaches of the stable layers in this case. So, you know, if you think that sunspots or toroidal flux ropes that will give rise to sunspots need to be stored for stability reasons, you know, right beneath the base of the convection zone, this is actually pretty cool stuff.
So periodicity is
40 years in this case. Well, 80 for a full magnetic cycle, but 40 if you look at just an activity cycle, four times the sun, something like that. That simulation is subluminous compared to the sun. Because of our forcing setup, the flux, the convective flux that traverses the simulation is not a knob I can tweak. It's something that comes out of the simulation. So for that one, it ends up being subluminous compared to the sun. We have another one that makes nice stable cycles, although it's symmetric about the equator. That runs at the solar luminosity, and the period goes down to, the cycle length goes down to 25 years instead of 40, so there's a dependency there. But the longest simulations we have, and I'll explain you why later, are the ones that run at the solar luminosity. That's what I've used for the examples here.
Where do the lags come from between the hemispheres? There's definitely a lag.
Yeah, and
in some of the cycles at least.
Yeah, I have a nice slide on that. It'll come up. So if you look at the things that these things do well or not so well compared to the sun, you know, it's a bit of a mix. So we do produce kilogauss strength fields. That's pretty good, large scale. They are anti-symmetric about the equator, and they do undergo fairly regular polarity reversals on you know, decades, a few decades, which is pretty cool. Our period is four times too long, and our fields are concentrated at way too high latitudes compared to the sun, which is not so good. The internal field is dominated by the toroidal component, and it is concentrated at the base of the convection zone, which is what a lot of people like to think, you know, you need to do to produce sunspots. We do get a well-defined dipole moment, I'll show you in a second, which remains very well aligned with the rotation axis. That is good, but it's oscillating almost exactly in phase with the deep toroidal field, rather than the pi over 2 phase lag that we see on surface observations. We get, I would call it, a reasonably solar-like internal differential rotation, and we get actually pretty cool cyclic torsional oscillations that have kind of the right phasing with respect to the sun, and they even have the right amplitudes in terms of nanohertz compared to what we see in the sun. So this is actually, I think one of my grad students gave a talk here, a science discussion a few years ago, Patrice Baudouin, that was his master's thesis project to analyze all of that. On long timescales, we do get a tendency for hemispheres to decouple. And we even see, and I'll show you an example later, we even see transitions to non-axisymmetric large-scale dynamos. So we seem to have long-term stability problems, if you want to call it that, in there. And part of what I'll tell you later about is touching on that. And we do get, as I said, this modulation of convective energy flux. We've run that simulation for actually now for 2,000 years. It's a low-res simulation, so we can actually afford to do that. It's still something like 25 million time steps. But this is, again, a time-latitude diagram that runs, you know, so same thing you were seeing before, effectively. That is a time-latitude diagram of the surface radial field. So you see here the dipole that I was talking about, and not much going on at lower latitude. And this is total magnetic energy integrated, you know, again, across the whole domain. So you see the signature of the cycle, and there's fluctuations, you know, happening. In an email exchange with Mark Meesh, he called this the Millennium Simulation, because we went over 1,000 years with it. And we used to call it internally MHD 37A. And I thought that Millennium Simulation is far sexier name than so this has now become the Millennium Simulation. And having so many cycles to play with, even though it's not the sun, we can start to do, you know, little statistics and stuff like that. So for the fun of it, you know, we've actually tried to see to what degree do we capture some of the variability that we see in the solar cycle in that simulation. So under the assumption that sunspots come from, you know, immediately beneath the solar convection zone, we've basically integrated, you know, in both hemispheres this blob of strongest magnetic field that builds up at mid-latitude. And we've called that our proxy of sunspot number. You know, usually we always think sunspots numbers are a proxy of magnetic field, and you don't know what the relationship are. We have the magnetic field, but we want to compare to sunspot numbers, so we need to go the other way. Which is kind of silly, but we're stuck with that. So we've done that. So this is our sunspot proxy in the northern hemisphere. This is sunspot proxy in the southern hemisphere. For reasons that are entirely coincidental, our cycle 24, you know, is actually low. And this is a complete coincidence. It has nothing to do with anything. And then we can play the usual games of looking at the distribution of cycle amplitudes, cycle periods, and compare that to what, you know, we do if we do the same type of analysis with the same pipeline on sunspot data. So this is an example of some of the correlations, you know, we try to pull out of this. So for example, here I'm trying to correlate the mean growth rate of my cycles with the peak amplitude of those cycles separately in both hemispheres. And these two things correlate quite well. And they correlate well in the sun as well. Other quantities, since this is the half cycle period in years, the amplitude, we get a weak anti-correlation, weaker than what we see in the sun. So, you know, some of these correlation values, you know, a statistician would kind of puke on you if you would argue that you got something at 0.3. But the fact is, you know, these are the sort of things that come out of sunspot data. I don't want to make too much of it, but one thing that is really interesting is that most of these types of correlation will get at least the sign right. You know, things that in the sun anti-correlate with each other, they tend to anti-correlate with each other in that simulation as well. And things that correlate positively with each other do it, you know, also in the simulation. The one outstanding thing that does not correlate at all in the simulation, and does in the sun, is the dipole moment of this cycle with the amplitude of the next cycle. There's a fairly strong correlation. Well, it kind of depends what you use for the dipole moment proxy, that is seen in sunspot number or in solar data that we don't see at all in this simulation. Another really funky thing that we found is this is a distribution of peak amplitudes in the northern and southern hemisphere. And, well, we don't have so many cycles, but in both hemispheres, we see this tendency for bimodality. And we see this population of weaker cycles, if you wish. And people who analyze cosmogenic radioisotope going back many, many years are finding evidence for a similar type of bimodality. I'm not quite sure what to make of it. We don't have so many cycles, and this is one piece of statistics that we're updating as we keep pushing that simulation farther and farther, but this was kind of an interesting analogy. Now, one thing that it gets even weirder when you start looking in detail at these cycles. So you might think that what you're seeing here, you know, is that every once in a while the cycle kind of goes low and then up again, and that's why you get this thing. But it turns out that the occurrence of these low amplitude cycles are completely decoupled. They never happen simultaneously in both hemispheres. What I've plotted here, just as dots, you know, is the peak amplitude of my proxy in the southern hemisphere versus the northern hemisphere. So So that's the distribution of these points. Now, these guys here below 0.6, 0.6 is kind of cutting it, you know, basically here. This is the what you might call the normal cycles. These are the weak cycles. There are no points here. And you know, we have six more cycles now, and there are still no points here. You can work out, if you work out the numbers, you know, between these low and high cycles, you can work out the probability of not having anything there. It's not vanishingly small. It's like 15%, nothing to write home about. But as we keep adding points, you know, nothing happens here. You see nothing like that in cycle periods. So it's like when one cycle goes weak, it prevents the other one from going weak. So there's a weird sort of hemispheric coupling that is apparently taking place in there that we just plain don't understand. To get back to your question, this is looking at the phase lag between the cycles. I look at times of minima and times of peak as I run along, and sometimes one cycle comes in before the other one. And if I look at how this lag varies as a function of time for my 40 cycle plus, you know, at the end of this, I'm still at accumulated a lag which is about only 10% of the cycle period. Now, if this were a random walk, you can easily work out the probability of this happening. And again, it's not, you know, vanishingly small, but it's at the 10% level. So there seems to be some level of coupling that gets these hemispheres to talk to each other, but it's rather unusual in its impact on cycle amplitude. And we're still trying to figure out how that might work.
Okay.
Yeah?
So in the Rosalskin work, which I guess is using tissue isotopes or something, yep, to do that, is there anything there to know whether that kind of hemispheric decoupling would be true for the observations? I'm guessing probably not.
No, because the cosmogenic signal really has nothing to do with, they can't tell hemispheres.
So then the other related question is, the weak cycles in their bimodal distribution, are they related to grand minima?
They possibly could. They're, we don't get grand minima in those simulations. In his data,
right,
they tend to be related to grand minima. Yeah, I suspect they are.
Can grand minima occur in a way where you have a weak, one hemisphere weak and one not?
Well, there's evidence that in the modern minimum, you know, the two hemispheres are not quite as suppressed. But again, from cosmogenic data, you can't get there. Okay, this double cycle business. This was actually a pedagogical experiment. These are three of my PhD students. And we noticed at some point, it started by having a long Skype discussion with Scott McIntosh, who was really keen on all this shorter timescale variability. And then we realized that we're seeing variability like that in the simulation. So that's when we did the pedagogical experiment. I was busy, so I told these three guys, okay, you guys figure it out. Go away. You know, mm-hmm, leave me alone. So these three students have really been trying to analyze the simulation to try to pull out this signal with very little intervention on my part. We just meet every once in a while, and you tell me what they mean, and I think it's good, but it's not. So this short variability is seen, and I mean, you know, stuff anywhere between half a year and 2 years maybe, is seen in a really impressive load of activity indicators. You see it in sunspot number, in the radio flux, total spectral irradiance. You pick it out in the P-mode acoustic frequencies. You see it in the interplanetary magnetic field. To some extent in the flaring rays. You see it in solar wind speeds. And if you want more, ask Scott. He has a much longer list. Of all these things. I've picked out a few examples. This is from helioseismology. So these are Steve Tomchek's old friends, you know, the Bison Network gang in Birmingham. What you're seeing here are variations in P-mode frequency splittings. So we have a baseline level, and as the solar cycle goes on, the red stuff is the solar radio flux. You know, the frequencies move around in frequency space. So something is changing inside the outer layers of the sun. The acoustic frequencies are set basically by the sound speed, which is set by the temperature. So when you see an oscillation in frequencies, you're seeing something changing in the structure, in the pressure field, or in the temperature field. So what these guys have done, they've taken, you know, they have like three cycles worth of splittings, not very good resolution here. And they fit a sinusoidal through there, and then they call that the mean variation, and they subtract that, and they get this signal, you know, that it's not a nice sine wave, but even by eye, you can tell that there's some sort of periodicity in there, or a time scale at least. And if they play the same game with the F10.7 radio flux, they get a similar sort of variation. This is a similar type of analysis done this time with gong data, where these guys have taken all the frequencies they have, you know, in different frequency ranges, so sampling different depths, and they've played the same game. So this is their raw data. And for the two frequency bands, they smooth out with a 2.5 year filter or something like that, and they subtract that smoothed signal from this, and they get, you know, again, something with a definite short period oscillation. And it's not 1 year flat. If it's 1 year flat, you worry that it's something about the orbit of the Earth. But it's not 1 year, it's more like 1.6 years in their case. This one's from Roger Ulrich. This is a surface magnetogram, a bit like the one I showed you very early on. And what you're seeing here, of course, is sunspot bells, sun's dipole moment reversals. So Roger does the same thing. He smooths this out. He smooths this out with also a 2.5 year filter or something like that. He gets this diagram, subtracts it from the previous one, and you get this thing. Again, with those streaks, this oscillation, you know, at some small time scale. The slanting of these things is likely due to the fact that the meridional flow is dragging stuff to the pole, but this kind of shorter period signal comes out pretty clearly. So, this is a time latitude diagram of our simulations, but now it's not at the base of the convection zone. It is well within the convection zone. It's in the subsurface layers on the convection zone. And again, toroidal field, zonally average, north pole, south pole, equator. And this is a radius time slice, you know, taken along this line. You know, and you can tell just by eye that there's definitely something going on in terms of a shorter period oscillation. So we can play the same game. We can play the same game. We can take this, for example, average it with a filter that is something like a quarter of the cycle period. We get this mean thing, we subtract it, and we get a pattern like that, which is, again, at some qualitative level, looks an awful lot like what comes out of Roger Ulrich's magnetogram. So this thing seems to be, you know, it's not, again, a nice sine wave, but it persists, you know, across, and this is just a small segment of the simulation. This runs like that, you know, for literally 1,600 years. We think we have an idea what might be happening. So if you think about what could produce short timescale oscillations like that, there's actually a lot of possibilities. Back in the late 1960s, I believe, Peter Gilman suggested that Rossby-type waves could produce oscillations on those timescales. And other people have worked on that, you know, in between. Jeff Kuhn worked on that for a while, and it's been around. I think Scott is getting interested into this as well. Scott McIntosh here. He sent me a preprint a while back. So this is one way that you could produce these oscillations, possibly. Superimpose a wave-like pattern on the long magnetic field distributions of the primary cycle. Another option is that you have two dynamos running simultaneously, and various people have produced mean field models that were trying to do that. This lady, Elena Belevolenskaya, has a few papers out where she makes these double dynamos, one living in a surface shear layer, one living deep down, and she can get these deep type patterns. So there's various possible explanations for this, and there are possibly even more than, likely many more than I know. And what I will probably, in fact, end with is try to convince you that what we're seeing here is really a double dynamo type situation. So out of these simulations, we have this procedure that allows us to extract what's called the alpha effect. This is a measure of the turbulent induction of large-scale magnetic field. And the alpha effect, or the part that generates the colloidal field, that's a tensor, so I'm showing you just one component, looks reasonable in the sense that it has some features that are those that people predict from turbulence theory. It peaks at high latitude, it decreases towards the equator, changes sign across the equator. There's a sign change at the base of the convection zone. So, you know, it's with amplitudes of the order of a few meters per second. So this is what comes out of the simulation. It's quite robust, and it doesn't vary much with the cycle. This is the angular velocity that comes out of the same simulation, averaged over the whole, you know, simulation interval. So again, a fair amount of shear at low latitudes within the convection zone, and very little shear elsewhere. And a little bit of a tachyphone at high latitude. So you have a differential rotation that peaks here and decreases dramatically when you go there. You have an alpha effect that peaks here and decreases dramatically as you go to the equator. So what we think is happening is that at high latitude, where we see the main cycle, the simulation is driving what in mean field electrodynamics would be known as an alpha square omega dynamo. This is basically a dynamo where even the generation of the toroidal field is driven to a significant extent by turbulence, not just shear by the differential rotation. And we're thinking that this little oscillation that is peaking at low latitudes is driven by a completely conventional alpha omega dynamo in the language of mean field electrodynamics, where this shear is really powering the production of the toroidal field. So these two dynamos operate in different regions, they rely on different physical mechanisms, so there's no particular reason that they should have, you know, the same period or anything like that. Now,
just to be clear, those are quite independent of any type of line.
Yeah. They would be independent of any of
they're physically separated.
Definitely. Now, if you believe this thing, if you just believe it because I tell you, I've got some nice, you know, seaside property in Montreal I can sell you. talk to me afterwards. Now, but if this is really an alpha omega dynamo, then it should obey what's known as the Parker-Yoshimura sine rules. So the dynamo wave, you know, should go in a certain way. And for a positive alpha effect in the northern hemisphere, any outwardly increasing angular velocity, the dynamo wave should propagate along these lines away from the equator. That's what basic mean field electrodynamic would teach you for this type of model running in the linear regime, blah, blah, blah. Okay? So let's look at that. These are snapshots taken just a few years apart. Remember that my main cycle has a 40-year period. So up here, we're looking at the full simulation. So we are near the max of solar activity with negative polarity in the northern hemisphere. This really doesn't move much, you know, in the course of 1.5 years. Now, if I do the same game as before, you know, I smooth the whole solution out with a 10-year wide filter, I subtract that, and I look at the residual, you know, you start to see stuff that is giving a hint that it wants to originate at low latitudes and move up to higher latitude. The southern hemisphere is more interesting here. I've drawn here the tangent cylinder. This is the place our main mode is really confined within that, and this mode seems to live outside of the tangent cylinder. So just this is not exceedingly impressive in a visual sense, but it seems to be compatible with the fact that these structures are moving away from the equatorial plane, you know, as you would expect if this was indeed an alpha omega dynamo. So here's the validation that we've done, and this is pretty funky. This you've seen before, so this is what I was showing you before. And what's down here is simply pulling out a time series here, you know, which is that thing, smoothing it out, and I get this residual that has this very nice, you know, oscillating signal. I told you I was capable of pulling out the alpha tensor out of that simulation. So we've done that. We've pulled out the alpha tensor, we've pulled out the differential rotation, and we've plunked all of that into a conventional kinematic mean field model. So there's a circularity in there, right? But so what happens if you do that? This happens. Okay? It doesn't look exactly like that. And you know, the radial range of depth here is different. You have to be a little bit careful. This starts at 0.6, this starts at 0.5, stops at 0.95, stops at 1. But you do get this mid to high latitude cycle that is much longer than this smaller type oscillations that takes place here. And if you play the game of extracting again at this latitude, you get again the same type of general pattern, you know, that we see in the simulation. Now, why is this validation test actually interesting? This is a kinematic mean field model. It has no dynamics into it. There cannot be any Rossby waves or anything like that in this model by design. It's kinematic. The flow fields are given. So the fact that I can actually produce these two oscillations with a fairly, you know, wide range of fairly big difference in period simply due to the turbulent electromotive force is telling me that this double dynamo scenario can build up without requiring that waves come into play. So I think what we're still in the process of writing all of this up, but we think that we have a plausible scenario, at least in this simulation, to explain, you know, this double cycle behavior. Whether the sun does the same thing is, you know, anybody's guess.
Are they out of phase for something?
Well, yeah, these things do interact. I mean,
I just mean that it seems like it goes blue red versus red blue. That's right.
Oh yeah, I mean, the one thing that happens in this model is that the main cycle is symmetric about the equator, whereas this one is anti-symmetric. And with mean field models, you often find that the lowest anti-symmetric and symmetric mode have very similar growth rates. So it just happens that this guy produces a symmetric cycle. If we could tweak things a little bit, perhaps, and get this to be dipolar, but that was not the point, you know. That wasn't really the point here. So I wanted to talk about Thekla-Klein instabilities. I don't have time to do that. That's the master's thesis of my student, Nicola Lawson. I will just skip to the last slide I had on that. Simply to tell you that, gets back to this thing I talked about at the beginning, our simulations, you know, often they will run, you know, nice cycles. That's, again, a time-latitude diagram. And you think everything is going fine, you know, and suddenly they start to do funky things. Like this one here ran for something like almost 400 years with a nice regular cycle. Everything is fine. Then the southern hemisphere skips a beat. You know, it fails to reverse polarity. We seem to switch in what would be a symmetrical cycle. And then, poof, things disappear. So once we saw that, you know, we were like, woo, Maunder minimum, woo, letter to nature, you know, Nobel Prize, all this stuff. But then, you know, we kind of took a rain check and looked at the magnetic energy time series. And the magnetic energy was not doing anything spectacular as we crossed this point. So we thought, oh, well, that's kind of interesting. So we went back and thought, hey, this is a time latitude diagram of the zonally averaged magnetic field, right? I've averaged in longitude. So we went back into the simulation. That's the cool thing about simulations. You cut and slice them, you know, every way you like. We went back and we picked one point in the meridional plane, mid-latitude, mid-depth, and we made and along the longitude circle, you know, we pulled out the magnetic field and we made a longitude time diagram. And that's this guy. Now, it's very noisy, of course, because now you're not doing any averaging. You're really sampling the stuff at one point. But you can see these vertical bands here, you know, corresponding to the time where I have a nice cycle, and this is what you would expect, right? If you have an axisymmetric field that flips polarity along a longitude cycle, everybody flips polarity at the same time, right? It's just so this banded pattern is exactly what you expect. This one is taken in the northern hemisphere here, so you don't see that strange cycle. This one is taken about here. Look what happens when we seem to lose the cycle. These things pick up a tilt. This tilt is an indication that the symmetry axis of the large-scale magnetic field, which up to then had been nicely aligned with the rotation axis, does, boom, tilts away significantly by about 60 degrees in this case. This thing is still cycling. Okay? The magnetic field strength has hardly gone down. The period has gone down a little bit. So this dynamo that was the simulation that was giving me a nice axisymmetric magnetic field chugging away, you know, cycling away, everything is nice. At some point, for reasons to this point best known to itself, decides to flip its symmetry axis to 60 degrees, 60-some degrees. Now, the reason I mentioned that is that all this instability business that I thought I could throw a few slides in on, we're thinking that this destabilization on long timescales of the simulations is actually due to the buildup or the runaway of a MHD instability that would take place in the stable layers of the simulation. Our stable layers are very strongly stratified and very weakly dissipative. There's really very little dissipation down there. And these are the type of physical circumstances in which all the instabilities that Maoshumi has looked at with Peter Gilman, things like the Taylor instabilities, all these things, you know, can potentially develop. And we think we've found the evidence that this is what is going on here inside this simulation. This is still work of course, ongoing and in progress. So where do we go next? That's my last slide. Obviously, we need to understand what sets the cycle period. Jean-Francois is working really hard to figure out physically what leads to this modulation of convective energy flux. This is what I was just telling you. We need to understand, you know, if these stackifying instabilities are really there and are really responsible for some of the long-term problems we're seeing. We're in the process of working with Antoine Strugarek, which was a PhD student of Sacha Brun. We used to work with Yuri at CU with the ASH code. So some of the ASH operation has moved to Paris, not Yuri, though. Antoine is now a postdoc in Montreal, so we are running a simplified version of these simulations to try to compare their simulations with ours, because there are similarities and differences that we would like to understand. And we need to get closer to the surface, you know, which is really tricky, because as you go to the surface, the vertical scale height goes down. That sets the size of your convective cells horizontally, so you have to pack far more points, you know, on each sphere. It's real tough, but obviously we need to get to that. And that is it. See, they seem fairly happy, the whole lot. So I'm a good boss. This is being supported. Not these guys anymore. I should take these out. But these are all the people I've been working with, and it's been fun, and we hope to keep doing it for quite a while. Thank you.
Thank you. Questions? Awesome.
In your millennium simulation?
Yes. I'll do it here. It'll be faster. You want to see the time latitude diagrams or things
no,
like that?
The field lines.
The field lines? Okay. This guy? This?
Yeah.
That thing?
So, yeah. You have the field, strongest field, just below the center of the circle field, right? The dashed line is your center of the circle field.
Yeah, it peaks. This is the interface between the stable and unstable stratification. So it's roughly the center, roughly the center of the Tycho line.
So, I'm wondering what is causing the strongest field there, just below the center of it.
Okay, if we work out the alpha tensor in there, it's a full tensor and it has a strong anti-symmetric component, which corresponds to this downward turbulent pumping. So the field accumulates there because it is being pumped down by the turbulence, and we do have convective overshoot. But because we have such a strongly stably stratified thing. Actually, I have another slide that shows this. It was in the part of the talk I skipped, but I can actually go to it quick. Our overshoot is really restricted to a couple of grid points, two, three grid points, and this is why we get this fairly sharply peaked accumulation. Let me see if I can just pull out that one slide. Yeah, this one is good. That's a better one to answer your question, in fact. So that's, again, at the peak of the cycle. This is actually a close-up on what goes on in the tachocline Cartesian. So North Pole is here, South Pole is there, that's the equator. This in green is the base of the convecting layer. And this blue line we've drawn here, okay, is what we call the extent of the overshoot in the simulation. So what we do, that's the upper plot, we calculate we take the radial component of the total flow, square it, and average it over spherical shells. So this is the vertical flow is really the convective turbulence. And that's that black line. Okay? And this is a log scale. Okay, I got 15 orders of magnitude in energy here. So this is UR as I'm in the convecting layers. It goes down a bit as I approach the interface between the stable and unstable layers. And then, poof, okay, almost 10 orders of magnitude drop within 0.69 and 0.72, 3% of the solar radius. And then, you know, it just goes down. So that blue line is this line here. So this accumulation is really peaking in this place where overshoot is just crashing into this very, very strongly stratified stratification and cannot go any deeper. And because we don't have because our dissipation really cares about velocity shears, and we don't have a lot of velocity shears down there, there's effectively very little viscosity to the spread, and there's very little magnetic dissipation to spread that field downward. It does spread, but very, very slowly. So that's why this thing is very strongly concentrated.
So I wonder if you comment on the following perspective, and that is that what I learned from this is that the 3D sun, as computed by you, is something that
it's not the sun; it's a simulation.
The 3D numerical experiment is telling me that if we go and try to attack this problem observationally, what we have is we have more or less got helioseismology, global helioseismology. They showed us the shear layers. Furthermore, we've got the surface differential rotation, and the kinematic models that have been built rely on the identification of shear and the tilt of active regions at the surface.
Absolutely.
Neither of which is a component of your dynamic model.
Correct.
So what I take from this is when we observe things in astrophysics, we better damn well be careful not to think that we're really observing the physical system and what's driving what. We're only observing the effects of some of these things very often. So for instance, the sun is an engine in which you're telling me the internal dynamics is controlling everything, which doesn't surprise me whatsoever. What surprises me is that people even consider that, for instance, the tilt of an active region at the surface and the advection down by the meridional synovial circulation could have a causal effect in something like a dynamo, and it's just a pure surface thing. I mean, how arrogant are we to think that the surface is where all the action is and where we can observe things? So this really bothers me a lot, and I wonder if you could comment on that.
Well, I mean, yeah, I can certainly comment on that. So this accumulation of decay products of active region is definitely observed. It is taking place, and as you say,
how do you know that's not emergence?
Well, no, that's what I'm saying. Okay, so the this process. Let's see. So this process here, you know, let's go full screen. It's way too small.
Isn't so, most of your emergence in exactly that region?
Well, okay, I'll get to that. That's not what I want. Okay, let me go back. Well, anyway, you know what I mean. So, yeah, I'll go straight to, because it just went by, this one. So this, again, you know, was a latitude time slice of the radial field in the subsurface layers, just below the surface. And indeed, I had a dipole moment. There are no sunspots in there. There are no decaying active regions. There are no, I stop at 0.95. There's no surface shear. There's none of that. And yet, this thing builds a dipole. It builds a dipole that fits polarities, you know, in phase with the cycle. So when we look then at a real magnetogram, the real sun, I mean, we only see the surface, but at least it's real. Whereas this simulations are, to some extent, like video games. So if you look at that, so it is quite possible that what you see at high latitude is some dipole driven from below, okay, that happens to be, you know, also receiving magnetic flux from the decay products of active region. I don't think there is any way that you could observationally rule this out. Sekou Tsuneta, back when he was trying to get support, you know, theoretical support for one of the solar sea options, was asking, you know, what it is that the dynamo modelers would like to know, you know, in terms of surface magnetographic observations. And I told him, well, one thing I would really like to know is get a real accurate flux balance for the polar caps. Now, how much of it comes from low latitudes? How much of it emerges from below? How much of it gets subducted? And he looked at me and said, this is very hard. I guess it is. He knows much better than I do. But you would need something like that. So you see this happening. How much of this polarity reversal is really driven by surface accumulation of surface decay products? How much comes from below? Even if you do that, how much of this does make it back into the interior? I would argue some must, because this thing has a reasonable precursor value in terms of, you know, trying to figure out what the next cycle will do. So that would suggest that maybe there is a feedback. a partial feedback at least. This may not be the dominant mechanism that regenerates the dipole, but it certainly feeds into it. This is, again, not a black and white answer, but that at this point is would be my guess.
Could I say something about that?
Sure.
I think Phil is asking about how much, how should you use what you see and can observe on the sun to actually relate directly into this model you have. But I also worry that there are other pieces of information that actually are quite relevant. As for the tilt of the dipole moon, you actually see that in the white light cone graph. So at activity minimum, if you look at this sinusoidal running I think you know those.
Yeah.
So that tilt is that it could be as much as 20 degrees. So I think that also have to be factored in. So if I look at your last plot where there was a tilt,
it
tilts at every cycle rather than there. You know what I'm trying to say?
Yeah, there's an important distinction there indeed. This, when I was telling you here that this thing flips.
For instance, did you take your simulation and take your toroidal flux as measured around the magnetic poles as opposed to the axis of symmetry defined by your rotation? You know what I'm saying? If you were to take the dipole moment's direction, then take the toroidal flux around that axis, would I then recover the need?
Yeah, we haven't done that yet, because indeed, when I say that this thing tilts, it is not like on the sun, where from the corona it looks like, you know, this dipole thing is tilting. This axis here is pretty much fixed, and the polarity is just flipping about that axis. There is no wandering of the tilt axis, as far as we can tell. But yeah, that's an obvious thing to do, to basically
do
a change of coordinate and bring, yeah.
Yeah. So for example, Hunhausen, at first when he picked out the distribution of the CMEs, and he did it around the rotational axis or geographical north, and he found that it was clearly related with that axis. But the relationship was so striking once he picked, instead of that axis, but the axis defined by the global dipole moment.
Yeah. No, these are obvious things to try here. It's often a manpower issue at some point. We're a small shop. Matthias?
Yeah, I have a question more of numerical nature, since you use implicit large eddy simulations.
Yep.
They sometimes do quite some miracles, like 10 gigs or features with only a few grid points. So if you take the simulations you presented here and just double the resolution, what stays robust, what changes?
Okay, at this point, we have not done so many high-resolution simulations because they take a lot of time. Well, I don't need to tell you that. They take a lot of time. We do have some at twice the resolution. The large-scale cycle, the longer cycle is actually hard to get in there. It comes and goes. Interestingly enough, that short cycle, I'll look later. I might have something on the laptop. That short cycle seems to be robust. That one remains quite nicely. It's the long one, the one we like better at some level, that seems to be a little less robust. The reason we didn't push that very far is that we are also realizing, just by running different experiments at lower resolution, that large-scale cycle that we like, if you wish, seems to be strangely sensitively dependent on the degree of stratification that we put, you know, in the stable layer under the convective layer. And that's what got us into this instability business, which I didn't really get time to talk about. So my idea was that before I burn up my yearly allocation on higher resolution simulations, I want to understand what is really setting the stability of this thing, and then, you know, do much higher resolution experiments under a configuration that, you know, will do something sensible. But not everything is robust, that's certainly. Alice, and then Johan?
Mine is a little bit like Matthias's question. So I was interested in the bit depth of your calculations, down to 128 bits in your floats or your doubles.
Well, we're running that in double.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so another experiment that you could try is just to reduce that instead of doubles, just reduce it to like half of that, and then similar to Matthias's question, see what remains and what does not.
I'm not sure if I had it on there, but we did this one experiment that's really, really scary. I normally wouldn't talk about that, but I know all of you guys more nearly so. So I'll talk about it anyway. If I think it's like, you know, we run this with checkpoints, you know, every you know, 5 years or so, we dump a restart solution. Everybody does that. It's really stupid not to. If I restart one of these simulations at the max, near the maximum phase of the large scale cycle, they pick up and everything goes fine. If I insist on restarting them exactly at solar min, okay, sometimes it's this the old Lorentz thing, you know, the fact that I write the tape and then I read again. Sometimes this thing within a few thousands of time steps will flip to this non-axisymmetric mode. So there is some numerical sensitivity that it's tied into. As soon as you have any sort of physical instability, you know, issues like numerical, you know, truncation, you know, are sometimes just what you need to kick you right in the pants. And we have some indications that things like that might be taking place, which is yet another hint that we have a physical instability that, you know, at some point can swamp the whole simulation. Johan?
Oh, you might have mentioned your low boundary condition for your low
temperature.
What is
the
low boundary condition?
Yeah, we.
You impose the solar solid boundary.
No, yeah, that's basically what we do. We do one more thing that is that we're kind of forced to do because of the fact that we have this strong stratification. This thing wants to generate gravity waves in the stable layer. We do not we're not anywhere close to have the resolution to catch these waves. So if we don't do anything, you know, after a while, the stable layer blows up because of these waves trying to propagate and reflecting on the bottom boundary. So our bottom boundary condition, our bottom boundary condition down here is perfect conductor, impenetrable boundary, you know, stress-free. And what we end up doing is that in the first few grid points, we put a sort of a friction term, something that will just damp out any sort of velocity that makes it down to there. And this is the way we kill waves. We have to kill them. Now, that means we're introducing an extra force term into the system, which is a really dangerous thing to do. So we've pushed that boundary back down to 0.5 instead of 0.6 and repeated the experiment, and it didn't seem to change the global behavior. So we have this fudge down there to kill the waves, but it doesn't seem to affect the magnetic behavior of the system. Yeah. Yes?
You mentioned that in the relativity zone, so no turbulence. So it seems that the turbulent diffusivity is very small.
Yes.
So my question is, how do you erase the tornado blast in the previous cycle?
Aha. Okay, well, that was the part of the talk I had to skip. If you guys don't mind, I can show one slide that will actually answer your question, I think, you know. Let's go. Getting there. This guy. Okay. So, question is, if I really don't have much going on in the stable layer, how do I go about reversing that bottom boundary and the blue state? So, these red and blue lines are the same ones I was showing you earlier. This is the base of the convection zone, and this is the base of what we call the overshoot layer in the simulation. What I've done here is I've computed the pointing flux, the flux of electromagnetic energy on integrating over a spherical shell. Yeah, I do that for all the spherical shells in my simulations. This thing is downwards almost all the time. So this is the solid line, there's the pointing flux integrated over the whole simulation time span. And then I've chopped out my simulations into maximum phase, minimum phase. That's these two curves. That's the maximum phase pointing flux, that's the minimum phase pointing flux. Except near the surface, you know, it's downwards all the way into the stable layer. So I know how many watts, you know, per square meter are going in. I can integrate the magnetic energy in there and see how much energy I have there. And then if I take that magnetic energy and divide it by this pointing flux, I get a time scale. Okay? 8 years. My cycle period is 40 years. So what that means is for a typical cycle, once I start reversing polarity in there and pumping field of the opposite polarity, it takes on average 8 years to cancel out what's there. And then I have more, maybe more, because that's the folding time, so maybe 16 years. And then another 16 years to build up the new polarity. So this is just a time scale argument, but it's consistent with this notion that the accumulation of the fields down in the stable layer is really a passive process. You accumulate it there, and then you cancel it with the stuff coming from the door. The story could stop here, except that we're finding hints that that toroidal flux system down there is not entirely passive. It goes unstable. So it's not just pumping from above that destroys it. It destroys itself due to some sort of instability. Some of you might be aware of Mark Leach's work on the magnetosphere instability using shallow water MHD. He had a nice paper in 2007 that he did on that. And if you do that, that's his paper. So that's the axisymmetric magnetic field, and that's the non-axisymmetric magnetic component. So what he's seeing is what, you know, is known as the clamshell instability. The toroidal magnetic field goes unstable, destroys itself, then he has these forcing terms, and you rebuild it, and you can get this periodic oscillation where magnetic energy goes from the axisymmetric component to the non-axisymmetric component. This is our axisymmetric fields and our non-axisymmetric fields. We see the same phasing pattern that's integrated in the stable layer. So it doesn't prove that we have an instability, but we seem to be seeing the same sort of clamshell-like behavior that Mark sees in his shallow water MEP. The big difference is that he has to put a forcing function to restore it. It's a shell model. Right? So he has to put forcing terms to replenish the magnetic field, to replenish the differential rotation. We don't. It's done just by stuff coming from above. So that's what I meant when I said that we have evidence that we have some instability going on down there. I'm fine, you know, but some polite people might not want to leave, but please do. I'm here for the afternoon, so we can keep talking about this forever.
So that's a follow-up question. So is most of these dynamo action actually happening outside the tachocline? The tachocline is mostly a place where you accumulate magnetic fields. So most of the alpha squared omega dynamo you're talking about is happening in the convection.
Yeah, our current thinking is that the actual dynamo action is really taking place in the convection zone. I mean, this guy Gizeru, I showed you his picture of, you know, my former collaborator. I unfortunately ran out of funds, and I had to, there was a UCAR word for this. I had to involuntarily separate him, I think is what they used to call it. I had to fire him because I had no money anymore. Anyway, he was convinced that this instability that might have been going on, you know, in the stable layer. Hold on. He was convinced that this stuff going unstable would actually drive the polarity reversal of the field in the convection zone. The polarity reversals are definitely, this is a radius-time diagram, right? So the reversals are definitely taking place first in the convection zone and then moving downwards. Having the pointing flux being always downwards, you know, supports again this notion. So, you know, he had all kinds of ideas on how this could take place, but at this point we've seen no, even if an instability is taking place down here, as I think it is, we have no evidence that it is feeding back in a significant manner upwards onto the dynamo. No direct evidence, at least, as far as the operation of the regular cycle is concerned. On the other hand, I think that if this instability goes runaway and some goes out of control, that might actually contribute to destabilizing the large cycle, and making it flip to non-axisymmetric or something like that. So the jury is out. But I think the main driving of the dynamo is in the convection zone.
You know, can I ask this question? I'm very struck by how to reconcile with the natural point that Bill brought up. I think every model of this kind, as you go along, you discover basic physics, and then you evaluate its implications, and it can be very uncomfortable here and there. And the resolution is not based on observation. It's really how well can you get to its physically justifiable self-consistent model. Because if you disagree with observation, that's not bad news altogether. You see, the observation is such a small set.
Yeah,
it may actually allow you to go look for something else that could resolve the issues.
No, I know what you're saying. I mean, this simulation is missing a lot of stuff. It's not running in the right parameter regime. It doesn't have a surface. It doesn't have sunspots. But at least on the range of scales that it resolves, it's dynamically consistent. It is you know, consistent with the equations of physics, and therefore I can go into that. It's like, it's almost like a lab experiment, you know, it's data.
It's interpretable.
Yeah,
in terms of
you can interpret it in terms of basic stuff that we like, conserving energy, you know, things like this. So from that point of view, yeah, you learn what physics is going on in that simulation. Now, if some aspects of it look like what you see in the sun, you might hope that some of the physics that you're learning out of this video game is actually, you know, carries over to reality.
And if it doesn't agree with observations, one could say it's hardly surprising because, you know, we start off with a model.
Oh, I mean, it would have been weird if we got all of it right the first time around. I mean, it would have been impossible. That was actually pretty exciting already, just to get the cycle, with a period not of 100,000 years, not of 5 days, but of something in decades. You know, that was actually pretty cool.
That reminded me of a question I had, which was, so I think you were saying that the dipole is in phase rather than out of phase with the toroidal.
Yep.
Is that related to the fact that the emergence is also at too high of a latitude and that you don't have a sort of you don't have the tilts in the back lake?
It's not just that I don't have the tilt. I have no emergences at all. I don't have sunspots. I have none of that. So in retrospect, you know, it would have been, in fact, probably unreasonable to expect that this thing would have the right phase relationship, because it seems that the transport of decay products of sunspots being carried to the pole has a significant influence on what happens to the polar cap. I mean, you know, lots of people...
It affects that phase relationship.
Absolutely. I mean, it really controls the timing of polarity reversals and stuff like that. So I'm thinking that even though this simulation is... And maybe even if the real sun is building a dipole internally that shows up at the surface, on top of it, you know, you got all this stuff that happens at the surface that adds up. So from that point of view, that disagreement in the simulation is one of the least worrisome. I think that it would have been really weird to get the right phasing out of that, because there are processes that are observed, that are known to take place, that are known to affect the timing of this reversal, that are just not in there. So you home? Well, yeah, you have to be, you're thinking of these time series I was showing, right? Well, okay, so what Yuhong is saying is that my magnetic energies are really at the same level as the kinetic energies. But you have to be a little bit careful. This is really the total kinetic energy, and this is the total magnetic energy everywhere in the domain. So if you look at the convecting layers here, you know, I got here I'm at like 3 kilogauss or something like that. There I'm down to maybe 0.3 kilogauss. I got a solid factor of 10 less within the convection zone. So in terms of, you know, turbulent dynamo action, if I try to see what is the ratio of the magnetic energy to the kinetic energy in the convection zone, you know, it's actually a lot significantly smaller than what you might infer from looking just at that time series plot. So we're probably looking at 10-15%, okay, in terms of kinetic energy, kinetic versus magnetic energy density. Now, if you go down here, and that's a significant chunk of the domain, your field is a factor of 10 stronger, and you have no kinetic energy. So if you integrate over the whole thing, you know, the end result is that your kinetic energy does not receive any contribution from this part, but your magnetic energy goes up a lot, simply because of this accumulation down there. But if you do it only in the convection zone, it's not equipartition. It's a significant fraction of, but it's not equipartition.
You don't
see the one, two, three, four, but we don't have the resolution for that at all. I mean, that's one project of a master's student who's starting in the fall. It's activating the grid scratching to get much better resolution. I mean, the overshoot is doing a lot of stuff here, and my overshoot layer is 4 grid points. Deep, which is a very, very scary thing to think about. So maybe we'll get, you know, I can make more accurate statements about the equipartition once we get the overshoot in that region, you know, once we get a better representation of the overshoot.
Do you understand which physical magnitude amplifies it here. So rapidly in the same layer. I mean, is it just diversion of the pointing flux leading to, I mean, in the end you need some source of energy still.
The pointing flux timescale argument is telling me that, you know, if nothing happens in here, just a downward pumping is capable of providing that magnetic energy in 8 years, which is about 20% of the cycle, the half cycle period. So that is probably consistent with the fact that this all comes from pumping above. Now, this being said, there is a bit of differential rotation down there that will also, you know, induce a bit of toroidal field.
But on the other hand, the differential rotation is very deeply maintained since it doesn't have much radius.
Yeah.
Need a strong red feature to amplify the field.
Which
mechanisms will be doing that?
Yeah. If that pointing flux timescale argument had given me a number, you know, like 1,000 years, then obviously this is not how I'm, you know, putting the field down there. Something else is happening. If the number had been, you know, 5 days, that would have been problematic as well. I mean, it means this whole thing should get wiped out, you know, in a tiny, tiny fraction of the cycle. The fact that that flux replenishment timescale ends up being a significant fraction of the full cycle period means that maybe it's at least consistent with the idea that this is really replenishment from above only, although I think not, because of these other things that we've been seeing down there. I think there is also dynamics going on down there, more of an instability nature type.
What is the nature of the pointing flux? I mean, I can see it's E cross H in SI units, and E is, you know,
U cross B, basically,
you know, whatever. So above that line, I can imagine it's dominated by elliptical convection or something.
Yeah.
Below that line, what's the nature of that, and why is it diverging?
Well, you know, down to here you get significant turbulence still due to convective overshoot. So I think that is what driving the pointing flux.
Okay.
Now, if you go much deeper,
you could imagine it going straight through that layer almost.
Well, the overshoot? No, the overshoot will not.
The pointing flux.
Right? You know. There is still a little bit of a pointing flux below the overshoot layer, but I'm not too sure what this is about. Every once in a while, you might have a really strong convective plume that goes a bit deeper. You know, I don't know.
So it's pretty much all convection.
That is my impression at this point. Yeah.
I have a intuitive sort of a discomfort. This model stuff. Which is the following, when I see so much churning about an energy or magnetic field comparable to connected energy, then there's a natural tendency for nature to be able to against me. So then a flaw will come through, and that does have up to the energy transfer. So this business of the luminosity not varying any more than a few tenths per cent is putting a very severe constraint. I mean, that's the reason why the sun, say, you know, is very stable. It's a star.
Mm.
So any major changes in the interior, then Hank Sprout to come along and say, well, there's actually not 100,000 years of very extremely long Kelvin-Helmholtz time scale to be concerned about. Or whatever, it's still going to take a long time for the interior to change.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I mean, that's a bridge we haven't crossed yet.
No, I know.
We're all aware one day we've got to get there. But those things kind of... You see, when you look at all your heavy, powerful toroidal flux at the bottom, if any one of them go crazy, we will have a hurricane of some sort on the sun. Because this thing also is very buoyant. How do you feel about that? That's all I'm asking.
Okay, I'll tell you a little story that gets... We'll get to an answer reasonably quickly. Many of you probably know Peter Foucault, you know, who worked a lot with Hank Sprout, and they're the ones who are saying that these thermal timescales in the convection zone are such that you could not get any sort of luminosity variation because the heat capacity of the convection zone is so large that, you know, it kills off anything. Now, Peter comes from Montreal. He grew up in Montreal. And until a few years ago, because she's passed away now, his mother lived in Montreal. So he came up to visit a lot and would always drop in on us. So I had endless arguments with him about this business of whether this diffusion approximation really makes sense. Now, if we look at the outer layers of our simulation, and that's what my students been looking at, we look at what changes in the convection when the cycle, you know, waxes and wanes. We look at distributions of, you know, convective velocities and stuff like that. The thing that changes the most, well, there's two things that change, but it's the ends of the distribution. So the modulation that we see in the convective flux comes from a relatively small number of fairly well-localized, very strong convective plumes, a bit like your hurricanes. I'm getting to the answer to your question. Now, imagine you do a random walk. Okay? If you take, you know, a million random walker and have them walk a million time steps, and then you measure where they are, and you do a distribution, it's going to look an awful lot like the solution of the diffusion equation if you put a delta function, a Dirac function, as a initial condition, right? And so it makes sense. This is the regime in which, you know, diffusion is working. Now, if you take 10 random walkers and they do 10 steps, you know, where they're going to end up is not going to look anything like diffusion. Diffusion doesn't work, right? Diffusion works when you have a lot of, you know, you go through a lot. This analogy between random walk and diffusion works when you have a lot of steps. So my argument with Peter is that this diffusive argument is valid only for long timescale type behavior. If the modulations come from a few discrete events, you're never going to capture that. In other words, convection is not diffusion. On very, very long timescales, maybe. But on timescales of, you know, short timescales of convection, you know, if all the action happens in a small number of discrete plumes, you're never going to be able to capture that with the diffusion equation. And that is what seems to be happening. Get this guy Cossette, Jean-François Cossette, to come and give you a talk on this. You know, or you do it too when he comes in at CU, because that's what he's been measuring, the nature of that modulation. It's not a global thing. It's associated with a small number of discrete events that really dominate that modulation. It's really cool stuff.
So if you're measuring the kickoff, overshoot, and the tag along from your simulation, you still get all these.
We've done a few in the context of this benchmark we're trying to do with the ASH code. They don't like to have stable layers down there because it introduces timescales. So we've taken out that. And based on the few runs that we've done, we have not yet found large cycles. So that stable layer is important. That lower boundary condition, you know, is really important somehow.
But some people are getting dynamo working without
Pac-Lon. Well, what they like the ASH people are getting these nice, you know, toroidal structures that are pressed at the base of the convection zone. In order to get reversals, though, they have to run these things, you know, at higher rotation rates, and there are some differences between the sort of results that we do. But certainly, based on what they're doing, it is clear that polarity reversals do not require a stable layer. That is certainly true. Some simulations give you that without stable layers. But for the setup that we're using, the stable layer seems to be playing a rather important role. It's not just a boundary condition. You know, it plays into the dynamics at some level that we don't yet completely understand.
I think there's more questions. Just following down for lunch.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you very much, everybody.
Thanks a lot, guys.